gossip.
TV.
Media, advertising and friends.
Food. Advertising.
Dodgy profile on the internet dating website.
Internet.
Family, friends, media.
By worshipping a counterfeit.
Friends. Is this one for the people?
Is this one for the Lord? No, I think people are happy to be deceived on a regular basis.
I think a lot of people are deceived by Hollywood.
I think people can be deceived by not knowing the truth and by blindly following their emotion.
People are being deceived, believing that they're happy.
I am very happy to see all of you here tonight, and I pray and hope that you will be blessed as you join with me as we study and to investigate the Bible together. Now, how many of you like to know something about the future? Let me see your hands. Okay, you are very curious about the future. Now, do you have any options to figure out what future holds? You have some options? I know there are many people in the world, they like to go to see a psychic, or they like to see a fortune teller, or I don't know if this is popular here or not, but in Asian countries, Asians like to see a fortune teller who can tell them about their future by looking at their hand. Isn't that pretty amazing? Do you believe that? Because, I don't know what they see. I mean, as far as I know about my hand, you know, it is pretty dirty sometimes. But, you know, there's one thing is for sure. People are pretty desperate about the future, meaning they want to know. They want to feel secure, and they want to be ready, whatever may happen to them in the future. This is an obvious, normal desire for a human being. Well, tonight I want to introduce to you the Bible. I believe Bible has more assuring words to us than any other books in the world today. You know, Bible already has made many, many predictions, and you can study the Bible very carefully, and you will be able to discover that those predictions have come true. And we have many more predictions that is pointing to the future. Now, when we are talking about the end of time, there is famous books in the Bible that specialize the end time prophecies. Now, these books are Book of Daniel and the Book of Revelation. But, however, there is a chapter in the New Testament. It is in some ways simple, but yet profound. So turn your Bibles with me to the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 24. To me, Matthew is a small chapter. Because when you study the book of Daniel and the book of Revelation, I mean, those two books are humongous, meaning there are so much information in those two books. But when you study Matthew chapter 24, things are put in a very simple way, but very profound way. So let's study the book of Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. And we're looking at verse 1. The Bible says this. And Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. So imagine with me, here you have Jesus and his disciples, and the Bible says they're what? They're coming out of the what? Temple. And then the disciples, the Bible says, they were trying to show the building to whom? To Jesus. Now, that's kind of strange, isn't it? Why do you think they were trying to show the building to Jesus? Why? Is it because Jesus never saw the building before? No. Why do you think? Well, the Bible does not say clearly, but something triggered them to show the building to Jesus. But then Jesus said something very shocking to his disciples in verse 2. And Jesus said unto them, see not all these things, verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. Jesus just gave them a shocking news. What did he say? He said, this beautiful building will be destroyed. It will be completely destroyed, so much so that not even one stone will be on top of another stone. Now, that expression is pretty amazing. You know, I went to New York City in 2001, September 22nd, 11 days after 9/11. I went to the place called the Ground Zero. When I went there, you can still see the smoke coming up from the ground. And the debris that that happened from the destruction, it was so high, it was tall as like 7-story building. Because when you see a building, you know, being destroyed, you usually see a big pile of debris, right? But the language of Jesus, not even one stone will be on top of another stone. You know what that means? Everything will be leveled to the ground. Whoa, what a shocking news. The disciples, they dare not ask him or inquire more details about this announcement or this prediction. So they waited until they went up to the mountain. In verse 3, the Bible says, and as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? When shall these things be? Meaning, when will this city or this temple be destroyed? And then they asked the question, what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? You see, you already know from the history, Jerusalem was destroyed when? 70 AD, right? And obviously, you know that the end of the world is not yet here, right? But the disciples did not separate these two great events because they thought that when Jerusalem is destroyed, that's got to be the end of the world. So they thought that these two great events, they have to take place at the same time. So when they ask this question, in their mind, they were asking how many questions? One question. But in reality, they were asking two questions. What are those two questions? When this temple or the city of Jerusalem be destroyed, and signs of the end of the world. Two questions. So what do we have in Matthew 24 and 25? In Matthew 24 and 25, Jesus is basically answering their question. And it looks like Jesus is giving them one answer, but in his one answer, we have two answers. Did you get that? Okay. So you have to remember this scenario. Now, so let me ask you something. I am sure you have studied and you have talked about the signs of the time, the end of the world. So let me ask you something. What are the signs of time? The war, the rumors of wars. Okay, what else? Earthquakes. Okay, now what else? Famine. What else? Floods. Fires. Okay, what else? Droughts. Okay, famines, pestilences. Okay. Giving to marriage. All right. Now, it is very interesting. Much of your answers are, if I can summarize them, most of your answers are related to what's going to happen to us physically. True or not? Yes? Yeah. Famine, you cannot eat. A flood and fire, there's a danger, right? Your life is being threatened. Pestilences, diseases, you get sick, right? Earthquake. And again, destruction. You know, it is very interesting when people talk about the end of time, they usually imagine what? Something bad is going to happen. What kind of bad things? What? Something is going to happen, and it's going to be really bad, and it's going to affect them physically. Now, it is true, Jesus does talk about much of these signs in his answer. But when Jesus gave his answer, his very first answer, it was not about, do you want to know the signs of the time? Do you want to know when the end of the world is going to be? Well, here's the first thing. Write it down. Global warming. Jesus did not say things like that. Jesus, he didn't even say things like financial crisis. But the very first thing that Jesus talked about, Jesus said in verse 4, and Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that what? No man deceive you. Question to you. Deceive, deception, is that more physical or mental? Ah. Many times we worry about what? Physical. So what happened? What did you do before Y2K? How many boxes of Wheat Bix did you buy? How many jars of Vegemite did you buy? Just in case. Now, I don't blame you, because even my in-laws, they bought cases of brown rice. Yeah, I mean, that's like preparing for flood or tornado. You understand? I mean, it's not like evil or dumb or, you know, wrong, but I mean, that's normal and natural. But my friends, you know, we have to think a little higher than that. We worry about our physical need, and that is understandable. But what Jesus, you know, what he is worrying for us, what is he worrying about for us? Our mind, our spiritual condition. Let no man what? Deceive you. Now let me ask something. Can you define scientifically, if you can, the definition for deception? What does that mean, to deceived? Okay, lie, what else? To accept falsehood, okay, what else? Counterfeit, very good. But there's something even more that underlines the purpose of deception. In the Bible, where do we have a very good example of deception? The Garden of Eden. So analyze what happened in the Garden of Eden when Satan, in the form of serpent, came and when he deceived the woman, what was he trying to do? In the process of deceiving her, what was he trying to do? Think. Yes, separate from God, that would be the spiritual result. But in the process of deceiving her, what was he trying to do? To lead her astray? Now, what does that mean, to lead her astray? Make her what? Cause her to doubt? No, okay. When he was trying to cause her to doubt, what is he trying to do? Yes, trying to deceive her. But in the process of deceiving her, what was he trying to do? You know, if I give you the answer, you'll be like, oh, is that simple? You know, sometimes we think too much. But more profound and more logical answer is simple. Yeah, I give you the answer. You ready for this? Deception is simply is to change the way you think and the way you feel. Yes or no? Eve, what was she thinking about the dream? Don't eat. Yes. And how was she feeling about the dream? Dangerous. Are you with me? But then after the deception, what is she thinking? This is good food. It will make me wise. You see, my friends, so when Jesus said, let no man deceive you. So what was he saying? Let no man change the way you think and the way you feel about God's truth. Are you with me? So let me put it this way. Yes, it will be good to be healthy for the last days. Yes, it will be good to be able to grow your own food in the last days. Yes, it will be good if all your debts are paid off before the last day. Yes. It will be good to have your own property in the last days. A hideout. Yes, okay. I accept that. But all these things, they become useless if you're being deceived. Because just because you're hiding in the cave, it doesn't mean you're saved. You can be deceived and also hide in the cave. Isn't that right? So let no man deceive you. By the way, I am going to prove to you from the Bible, not my opinion, not your opinion, the teaching of the Bible, I'm going to show you that the biggest burden that Jesus had for his disciples and for us, let no man deceive you. How do I know? Look at it. It's in your Bible. It's not only in my Bible. It is in your Bible as well. look at in verse 5. Did Jesus use that word deceive again? For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall what? Deceive many. That's the second time Jesus used that word deceive. But then that was not enough. Look with me, verse 11. And many false what? Prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. Third time. But that's not enough. Look with me, verse 24. For there shall rise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that, if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Four times. Now let me ask you something. I'm sure you know how to communicate. You know how to talk. When you are trying to get your point across, there are many ways, there are many methods in order for you to communicate, in order to get your point across. But what method is the most popular method that people usually use to get your point across? Repetition. And mothers are really good at using this method. Yes or no? It's true, right? Repetition. Okay, repetition deepens impression. Okay, if you really want to say something, repeat, 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 repeat. And I usually tell my friends, when your mother is telling you something, you better listen. If she tells you twice, it's a warning. If she tells you three times, you better get scared. If she tells you the fourth time, run for your life. Jesus used that same word four times. Do you think that says something? What do you think? Do you think that's very important? I mean, if yes, yes, I am not lessening the importance of physical preparation. Now, there is a room for that. I understand. But that is not that important as mental and spiritual preparation. You know what that means? In the last days, people are going to be lost much more based upon what they think, much more than not because they do not have enough food. So if you're going to stockpile something, what should you stockpile? More wheat beats, Marmite, or more truth? If you are going to follow the suggestion, the guidelines that Jesus is giving here, you better know your truth. So then, tonight, so let's just make it really simple. Because look, I'm a simple person. You know, just to let you know who, you know, my background, I used to break dance, DJ, long hair, graffiti artist. I was a homeboy, okay? I like to make things simple. Let's just put it really simple. Preparation for the last days. Guess what it is? Be prepared not to be deceived. Exactly. So then, do you know what you believe? And how do you know what you believe? Here's the test. If you really believe something, you should be able to explain it. You should be able to show it from the Bible. If you cannot explain, if you cannot show what you believe from the Bible, guess what? You may change what you believe today. So then, the preparation for the last days, what is it? Know the truth. But how do you know that you have the truth? How do you know? If you can explain it clearly from the Bible. This is the reason why, my friends, it is important for us to know that we need to stand upon the solid ground. Amen? Now, let's do a little more investigation into this picture. Who is deceiving in verse 5? And please, you know, when I ask you this question, please don't look at my face. I don't have answer on my forehead, okay? The answer is in your Bible. Amen. Now, who are the people? Who are these people that are deceiving? What does the Bible say? The Bible says what? I am Christ deceiving many. Can we call them false Christ? Yes, okay, false Christ. All right, in verse 11, who are the people that are going to deceive? Verse 11, false prophets. And in verse 24, who are the deceivers? False Christ and false prophets. Isn't that interesting? First, false Christ. Then, false prophets. And then, false Christ and false prophets. It's like they are working together as one. Isn't that interesting? Okay, another question. In verse 5, how many people are going to be deceived? Okay. They are going to deceive many. In verse 11, how many people are going to be deceived? According to the Bible, many. In verse 24, if it were possible, how many are going to be deceived? The very elect. So, first, false Christ. Many will be deceived. Second, false prophets. Many shall be deceived. And then, false prophets, false Christ and false prophets. They are now trying to deceive the very elect. Now, when you think of that word, elect, do you imagine many people or small people? According to the Bible, usually, my friends, when the Bible says elect, it's usually what? Minority, right? So what's going on here? Many are deceived. And then, if it were possible, they are trying to deceive the very elect. Is there a sequence to this? Is there a progression? Is it possible we have this kind of sequence? Let me explain. First, false Christ are deceiving many, but not everybody. Are you with me? And then, false prophets are deceiving many, but not everybody. So who is left? Many are deceived. Who is left? Perhaps the very elect. So somehow, these elect, they are not being deceived by false Christ and false prophets. So what do? They join their forces. And are they using even stronger power to deceive? Yes? Because in verse 24, the Bible says they use what? Signs and wonders. They use miracles. They're increasing their power of deception. So then, what can we conclude? Simple conclusion. Somehow, we need to be part of that elect that are not going to be deceived. And how are we going to do this? We need to make sure that we know the truth. So let's go back. Matthew 24. And verse 5. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Now let me ask you something. What kind of people are these? People that say, I am Christ. It sounds like they're religious people, right? What kind of religion? A Buddhist? Hindu? Muslims? What kind of Christians? What kind of religion? Christians. Why? Because they say, I am Christ. You know what Jesus is saying? Jesus is saying that the most dangerous people in the last days are going to be Christians. How many Christians do we have here tonight? Let me see your hands. You are dangerous. Or you can be dangerous. Christians can be very dangerous if they claim to know the truth, but yet they're holding false teachings. All right. So, what is Jesus saying? Jesus is just simply saying, in the last days, if you want to know if my coming is near or not, you need to see. You need to see what is going on around you. But what should we look at? Well, what Jesus is saying here, you look at the religious world in the last days. There are so many things to look at. Yes, I know. The global warming, financial crisis, earthquakes and volcanoes and tsunamis and all these things, yes. But don't forget what Jesus is saying. Understand what is going on, what is happening in the religious world. After this, in verse 6, Jesus says, and ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. Now, I want to share something with you, okay? Now listen very carefully. When you study the Bible, many times when we read the Bible verses, we read them as though the verses are not connected. And that is true in some places in the Bible. I understand that. But many cases, when you read the verses, many times they are connected. And please don't read the Bible as though you're reading a writing from a philosopher, like a writing of Confucius. You know, do you know who this Asian guy was? Confucius. I haven't read his writings, but just to give an example, sometimes these philosophers can be so disjointed when they express their words of wisdom. For example, I'm just making things up. They may say things like, the sky is high and blue. And the next line, when I see flowers, I get hungry. Is there any connection? Probably not. Don't read the Bible like you're reading a writing of a philosopher. Now, is it possible that there's a connection? Let me ask you something. In verse 6, the Bible says, and ye shall hear of wars and what? Rumors of wars. Now, in order to have rumors of war, what do you have to have? People talking about it, right? So who are these people? Who are, what kind of people do talk about wars and conflicts? Politicians, exactly. The government officials, right? We're talking more of the political powers, yes? Ah, now catch this. Verse 5 is more religious, yes or no? And then verse 6 is more political. Ah, what is, so do you see a connection? You know, when you study the world history, what happened in the religious power, in the religious world influences the political world, exactly. So therefore, what is Jesus trying to say? It is very possible that Jesus is saying, if you want to know the nearness of my coming, study very carefully what is happening in the religious world and political world and how they are influencing each other. Are you with me? So, if we know this, guess what? We need to be interested in the religious affairs and the political affairs. Not that you have to know everything. Not that you have to be part of a political party. No. But at least you should know what is going on. Or are you one of these type of people, I don't care. It's a big headache. Who cares? What I care is about shopping, having fun, spend time with friends, get a good job, buy a nice car, have a nice credit card, and have a nice husband, and have a nice wife, and have a good life. This kind of dream, it may not come to fulfillment in our generation. I mean, listen, I'm not saying you should not work and study and make money. You can do that, please. I'm not saying you can go to heaven faster if you become very poor. That's not what I'm saying. It's okay to study and work and make money. However, don't forget your mental and spiritual preparation. So Jesus is saying, watch what is happening in the religious world and the political world. We continue. In verse 6, it says, see that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. Continuing. Verse 7. For nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. Is that, do we see a progression, yes or no? Before, rumors of war. But now they're what? They're at war, right? They're fighting. Not only nation against nation, but kingdom against kingdom. So definitely, based upon that observation, it is very possible that these verses are written, recorded in a such a way that we see a progression, a process. Continuing. In verse 7, for nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. Right after this, what do we read in the Bible? And there shall be what? Famines and what? Pestilences and what? Earthquakes in various diverse places. If you have to summarize all those things in one word, what word would you use to describe all of them? Calamities, disasters, crisis, Disasters? Okay. Let's just call it disasters. Natural disasters? Yes? Okay. What about man-made disasters? Can man cause famine? Can we cause pestilences and diseases? What about earthquake? Maybe. Let me tell you something, okay? When you have a chance, go on YouTube and just type in man-made earthquake. And guess what? We have the capability to do this now. But that's not my point. My point is not man-made or whatnot. My point is the Bible does talk about disasters. Do you see that? But let me ask something. Why is it that, you know, these disasters are written in this order? Meaning, why famine first, and then pestilences next, and then earthquakes? Or am I asking just too many questions? What's that? Weakens people. Okay, no, okay. What do you mean by that? What do you mean by that? Okay, now let's analyze this even more, okay? Watch this. Famine. What's the problem? Hunger. Okay. Okay. Is that a problem? That's a problem. Pestilences. What's the problem? Diseases. Okay. Earthquake. What's the problem? Destruction. Do you see something? It sounds like the problem is getting worse and worse and worse. Compared to hunger and diseases, which one is worse? Obviously, diseases, right? Between diseases versus things are being destroyed, what do you think is worse? Yeah. It is very possible that these things are written in this order, trying to communicate the fact that in the last days, things will get worse and worse and worse. Now, let's think even deeper. You ready? When things go worse, bad to worse, okay, what is the natural reaction of the people? Panic. What else? Panic. Besides, I'm looking for other words. They get scared. What else? What's that? Irrational. Okay, getting close, yes. Self-preservation, okay? But things are getting worse. In the beginning, to start with, no food. And then you're sick and hungry. And then you have no place to live. How do you feel? Hopeless. There's another word for this. You become desperate. Now, why do I emphasize that word? Desperate. Hopelessness. Because when you are so desperate, it causes you to be irrational in order to survive. Are you with me? Are you thinking? I know what you're thinking. Maybe some of you are thinking, you know, disasters are bad, but they do bring us closer to God. Yes, they can. But for some other people, disasters can cause them to become desperate. And listen very carefully. When you are desperate, listen, you are ready to believe anything in order to survive. Yes or no? So I see a chain reaction here. First, we have a religious problem. What problem? Many deceivers and many people are being deceived. And it is very possible that deceived people are part of causing the war. So, religious downfall and then political downfall. And because this becomes actual battle between, war between nation against nation. But then things get even worse. Famine, pestilences, and earthquake. Now people are super desperate. Meaning, they're panicking, ready to believe whatever in order to live. You know, when I was 16, I was so desperate. You know, I was the number one break dancer. I was doing DJ. I was pretty popular, but I was so desperate. Why? I'm number one in many things, but I got a problem. What problem? I have a pimple on my face. Acne. We call them zits. My friends used to call me pizza face. Pepperoni pizza. Oily face. Oh my. You know, in my mind, if I can have a clean face, I can be more popular. So I tried everything, I think. Do you guys have clear cell here? I tried that. I tried that. It didn't work. Do you have like Oxy 5? You have that? Amazing. They still have that here? Oxy 5. Do you remember Oxy 5 and the stronger stronger one? Oxy 10? Yeah? I was looking for Oxy 15. Where? Someone says, you know, try salt water. I try salt water. I took, you know, salt bottle to my bathroom or washroom to wash my face. Someone says, you have to wash your face with spinach juice water. One day, my mom was cooking spinach. And I asked her, Mom, what are you going to do with the juice? Why? I want it. Why? I want to wash my face. Someone told me, Peter, you know, when you're desperate, you're ready to believe, yeah? He said, Peter, I know what can help you. What? You know, I used to have a pimple, but, you know, every time I go through winter, cold air, it can just take your pimples away. And when he told me this, and, you know, and his hand motion and his words are so convincing. It's like, shh, take them away. And I can imagine in my mind, all my pimples are going, and they're all going away. And I'm like, okay, I will do that. And guess what I did? I was living in the state of New Jersey, right below New York. During winter, it's really, really cold. Guess what I was doing? I was leaving my window open when I was sleeping. Why? I want a clean face. When you are desperate, you are willing to believe anything. It is very possible, my friends, all these things are being set up for final deception. So then the question is, today, when you are hungry, when you are sick, when things are not going well in your life, Do those things cause you to panic and become irrational? Or do they cause you to come closer to God? When things go bad, do you blame God? Or do you allow them to cause your knees to hit the floor and you are in your praying position? Because, my friends, it is very possible that the way we react to bad things in our life right now, it may prepare us for the last days, or it may prepare us to be deceived in the last days. How is your emotion? Do you panic easily? Do you go out of control easily? When things don't go the way that you want them to go, do you get mad, angry, frustrated? You demand and you want to control. You want to just take over. You blame other people, pointing fingers. Is that the way you react? Guess what? If you're reacting that way, impatient, frustration, anger, and mad, and blame people. If this is the way you're reacting today, guess what? You are preparing yourself to be deceived. Because, my friends, again, Jesus saying, let no man what? Deceive you, and that includes you. Sometimes, my friends, the biggest deceiver is us. Self-deception. Continuing, quickly, the Bible says, all right, so again, let's study the sequence, the chain reaction, religious downfall, all right, and then political downfall. Nations are fighting against nation. And then what do we have? Natural disasters, or just simply disasters. And then what is coming next? In verse 8, the Bible says, all these are the beginning of what? Sorrows. Now that is very interesting. Jesus said, when you see these things, all these things, not just, you know, not just seeing what's going on in the religious world, not just seeing what's going on in the political world, not just natural disasters. No. When you see all these things put together, how religious world, how political world, with the disasters, how they begin to formulate the end time scenario. When you see all these things together, guess what? This is the beginning of sorrow. Now, if you study the word sorrow in the Greek language, because the New Testament, it was written in Greek language, and if you look up the word sorrow, you know what it means? Birth pain. This is the beginning of birth pain. Do you know anything about birth pain? Thank God I don't have to know about this. You know, I have a wife and 3 children. So I know what it's like to watch someone having a baby. You know, she woke me up 3 a.m. in the morning. Why is it the babies usually come after midnight? We need to have a better appointment with these babies. And my wife is like, honey, this is the time. I'm like, okay, where's the bag? let's get ready. And here we are driving to the hospital. And then she goes through this pain. And then a few minutes later, no pain. And then pain again. And then no pain. And pain again. It drives me crazy. It's like, make up your mind. push. I don't know. What to do? I have no idea. I tell you, when the baby came out, I said, praise God that I'm a man. Thank God for ladies. Amen. Amen. Without you, we cannot be here. God bless you, ladies. But there's something that we can learn from labor. I believe they call that contractions. In the beginning, the time between contractions is long. But when you get closer to the actual birth, the delivery, it gets shorter, and the pain gets more intense and stronger. Isn't that right? Yeah, I have no idea, but that's what they told me. And I saw it. And the Bible used the word, this is the beginning of sorrow. You know what that means? Things will happen, bad things will happen, more closer to each other, and the intensity, it will get stronger and stronger until Jesus comes back. What I'm about to share with you next, this may shock you. We're looking at the chain reaction, right? So look with me, verse 9. The Bible begins, in verse 9, the Bible says, then shall they deliver you up to be what? Afflicted and shall kill you. And you shall be hated of what? All nations for my namesake. And you're thinking, what is so shocking about that? One thing is for sure, that is talking about coming persecution upon God's people. Is that clear? But there's a subtle message. What message? Listen. How many nations? All nations. What are they going to do? Hate God's people. Yes or no? Okay, now listen very carefully. When nation is against nation, when kingdom is against kingdom, are they united or divided? They're divided, right? Okay. When all nations hate God's people, are they united or divided? United. Interesting, isn't it? They used to be divided, but now they are united. They became united. And the question is, what caused them to be united? Just ask yourself a simple question. What happened in between? Disaster. We have to learn to read what's going on in between the lines. Nations are against nation, and then what do we have? Famines, pestilences, and earthquakes. And then Jesus said, when you see all these things, this is the beginning of sorrow. And then Jesus describes what's going on in the last days. All nations will be united to hate God's people. That means nations, they changed. Yes or no? They used to fight each other, but now they are united. United against God's people. What caused them to be united? Disasters. Do we see that happening today? Are we seeing that today? Global warming? Financial crisis? Terrorism? Is it possible that these words are actually describing what has been going on in past 20 years? And the question is, why that they all get together to hate God's people? They're looking for somebody to blame. Blame for what? All the disasters. And you're thinking, that's ridiculous. Are you telling me that these people are going to get together to hate God's people, and they're going to blame God's people for famine, pestilences, earthquake? Can you imagine if somebody would come to you and says, hey, because of you, we had that earthquake last night. How would you feel? Ridiculous, right? How can you believe that? I'll be like, really? I caused that? Whoa, I'm that powerful? But listen, when you become so desperate, you are willing to believe anything. So I want to ask you something tonight. We're not finished with the story. We'll continue tomorrow. But as you can see, the end time scenario. Where are we going so far? What are we seeing? We're seeing psychological chain reaction. And then our question is, the question for us is, what are we going to do when the whole world hates us? How are we going to react? Are you going to panic? Are you ready for this? If the final event is going to be very similar to hurricane or tornado, we can go somewhere and hide. But let me tell you something. It is going to be mental, spiritual, psychological storm that's coming. And the only way to be prepared for this, your mind has to be connected to God. This is the only way. And the best way to be connected with God mentally is the Word. So I want to challenge you this evening, as you listen to our final song, think about the way you are preparing for the last days. What are you doing? What are you feeding your mind and your heart?
Ring that bell, you heathen from the city that dreams. Ring them bells from the sanctuaries across the valleys and streams. Oh, they deepen their wide, and the world's on its side. And time is running backwards, and so is the bride. Ring them bells, St. Peter, where the four winds blow. Ring them bells with an iron hand, so the people will know. Oh, it's rush hour now on the wheel and the plow, and the sun is going down upon the sacred cow. Ring them bells, St. Martha, for the poor man's son. Ring them bells so the world will know that God is one. Oh, the shepherd is asleep, and the willows, they weep, and the mountains, they are filled with lost sheep. Ring them bells for the blind and the deaf. Ring them bells for all who are left. Ring them bells for the chosen few, who will judge the many when the game is through. Ring them bells for the time that flies, for the trumpet cries when innocence dies. Ring them bells, St. Catherine, from the top of the room. Ring them bells from the fortress where the lilies they bloom. Oh, the lions they long, and the fighting is strong, and they're breaking down the difference between right and wrong.
Thank you. Do you know anyone in the Bible, someone in the Bible that went through hunger, diseases, and sort of earthquake, like disaster? I'm thinking of Job. What do you think? Yeah? When the Bible talks about Job, you know, when the Bible talks about Abraham, the father of our faith, when the Bible says about David is known for his courage. Samson, his strength. Solomon, his wisdom. Jeremiah, his tears. Job, according to the book of James, Job is known for his patience. So what kind of character do you have to have in order to go through famine, pestilences, and earthquake? Patience. And it is very interesting, in the book of Revelation, chapter 14, verse 12, here are the patience of the saints. Let me ask something. Do you have someone in your life bringing disasters to you? Small ones? Cause you to panic, irritated, frustrated, angry, mad? Cause you to be irrational? We need patience, amen? And next time when you see that person that brings disaster into your life, give him or give her a big hug and say, thank you for preparing me for the last days. Amen? So embrace the person that brings disaster into your life, because we better be ready mentally. What do you say? It's a spiritual preparation. I don't care if you're if your hideout is like totally secret and is totally, you know, protected, there's no place to hide. The only place to hide is to hide in the heart of Jesus. Let's stand for prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, we're so thankful that we can come here this evening to learn your word. And Father, we realize that in many ways we are not ready for the last days. We can see it very clearly that mentally and spiritually we are not prepared. So we want to surrender, we want to open our hearts and our minds to you. Because the only way we can have mental and spiritual strength, we learn to have that complete rest in your love and in your truth. So please teach us and to guide us that we may stand on the solid ground, especially in the last days. So we thank you. May we learn to lean more upon you and open our hearts to you, that we may have new character and new mind. We ask in Jesus' name.